life for me. I will thank him for the love that he gave me. And 10,000 years or more I'll reign with him.
The other day I was visiting a man who recently found out that he had terminal brain cancer. And he began to share with me his story and talking about his declining status and all the things that he had been through in life. And then he said, "I wanted to speak to you as a minister, because I've got a question that's really pressing my mind." He looked at me and he said, "I know that I accept God, but will God accept me?" You see, that question plagued Job as well. In Job chapter 9, verse number 2, he asked, "How can a man be righteous before God?" Miss Connie already mentioned that during the month of October 31st, we celebrate as believers Reformation Day. It was the floodgate opening moment of the Protestant Reformation when Martin Luther in 1517 nailed the 95 Theses to the doors of the church there in Wittenberg, Germany. And Martin Luther, as a monk, he struggled with a sensitive conscience. He struggled with a sense of guilt. He struggled constantly with anxiety over his sinfulness. He was constantly concerned that he hadn't done enough to satisfy God. Well, to these concerns, there is a beautiful doctrine in the Scriptures. Really, the great doctrine that Luther is known for recovering and rediscovering and reinstituting among Christian people, and that is the doctrine of justification. And that's what I want to preach on this morning, the doctrine of justification. And I invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter number 3. Romans chapter number 3. I want to read this morning from verses 19 down through verse number 26. Romans chapter number 3, starting with verse number 19, and we'll read down to verse 26. Paul writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit these words. Romans 3, verse 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it is to those who are under the law that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in His sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe. For there is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as the propitiation by His blood through faith, to demonstrate His righteousness, because in His forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed, to demonstrate at the present time His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Here the Apostle Paul begins laying out and describing the foundation of this wonderful doctrine of justification. And I want to help each of you understand what that doctrine is this morning, and so that you can be assured and comforted and encouraged that a person, even yourself, can be accepted by God. And I want you to understand that it's possible through the doctrine of justification. First of all, I want to talk about the meaning of this term justification, the meaning. Now, the term justification is a judicial term. As a matter of fact, we see this term used in the Old Testament. If you hold your place in Romans and turn over to Deuteronomy chapter 25. Deuteronomy chapter 25 and verse number 1. And that's the fifth book of the Bible in the Old Testament, one of the books of Moses, Deuteronomy chapter 25 and verse number 1. And here we see that concept of justification as a judicial term being played out in everyday life. Deuteronomy 25 verse 1 says, "If there is a dispute between men and they come to court, that judges may judge them, and they justify the righteous and condemn the wicked." Now, do you see that right there? The idea of that term justification being used in a courtroom in a legal sense. Here, to justify entails judges or a judge pronouncing, declaring a person righteous, and in this case, innocent of a certain particular crime. Now look back in Romans chapter number 3. And as you look back in Romans 3, where we read from, that term justified, just, and justification is used several times in the passage that I've just read. There in Romans 3 and verse 20, Paul writes about being justified in his sight, in God's sight. In other words, in God's sight, declared righteous. That's the basic meaning, declared righteous. Verse number 26 tells us how that God is the just judge and he's the one who justifies us. In other words, he is the just, righteous, holy judge, and he requires us to be justified in order to be accepted in his sight. And he does this by justifying, doing the work of justification. Look at verse 24 of that same text. Paul writes, being justified freely by his grace. The idea of being justified freely has the idea of a person being placed in that state by God where they are justified by God and before God. Now imagine someone standing before us today, a man, he's got a great record of crimes that he's committed, and the governor of Tennessee walks in the back door and looks at that man and gives that man a pardon. Now when that man receives that pardon, the man is still guilty of his crimes. He's still a criminal. But his sentence through the pardon has been removed. See, a pardon erases the legal consequences of a person's convictions. Yet, this man would still be guilty, and he is not innocent. He's bypassed the punishment, but he's still guilty. He's still not innocent. However, folks, God, when he justifies us, he doesn't simply pardon us. It's better than that, though he does. He doesn't simply declare us innocent, though he does, and it's more than that. He doesn't simply forgive us, though he does. But you see, justification involves more than a pardon, more than being declared innocent, more than forgiveness. It means to be declared righteous and to be placed in a righteous state and standing before God. If you want to jot this down in your Bibles or your notes, this definition. Justification is that judicial act of God where he declares and pronounces a believing sinner righteous in his sight. You want to jot that down? Here it is again. Justification is that judicial act of God where he declares and pronounces a believing sinner righteous in his sight. Well, that's the meaning of the term. Now, let's talk about the need for justification. Now, why would someone need to be justified? Well, I just said that God is holy, God is righteous, God is just. And just as you've seen in this passage in verse 23, every single one of us are sinners. We're all sinners. Look there in verse number 9 of chapter 3. What then? Are we better than they? Not at all. For we have previously charged both Jews and Greeks that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Underscore that. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good. No, not one. Their throat is an open tomb with their tongues. They have practiced deceit. The poison of asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Now, do you see that? We're all guilty. We all sin. The law of God comes as a judgment, pointing out to every one of us that we stand guilty with a guilty record before Almighty God. How is that? Because we're born as a sinner, inherited that sin nature from Adam, and we do sinful acts. You say, what do you mean by sinful acts? Well, just think about the Ten Commandments. We've broken the Ten Commandments. And you know, the Bible says if you've broken one, you've broken them all in God's eyes. So we're all guilty. We're in need of being justified if you and I are going to be accepted by God. And so that leads me to my third point, and that is the way of being justified by God. How does God justify a person? How can you and I be justified by God? Look at verse number 20 of chapter 3. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. Now, what is Paul saying right there? He's saying that by obeying the law, that is not going to justify you before God. In other words, none of us one day can stand before God and say, God, even if we did do this, none of us could stand before Him and say, God, I've obeyed every one of your Ten Commandments. I've never broken them in my entire life. God, I'm ready for you to accept me now. Even at that point, we still would not meet the righteous standard of God, because it's not by doing the law that one is justified. Galatians chapter 2 and verse number 16. This is a good scripture for you to write down to look up later. Paul writes, knowing that a man or a woman or a boy or a girl is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. So the works of the law will not justify a person. Religious duties and actions will not justify a person. You can read in chapter 4 of Romans how that Paul gives a discourse about the justification and the faith and the righteousness that Abraham received. Now, was he declared righteous and justified by God because he was circumcised? No. Verse number 11 clearly says that Abraham was declared righteous before he was ever circumcised, because he was declared righteous by God based upon his faith, taking God at his word. And we as believers, we are commanded to pray. We're commanded to assemble with other believers. We're commanded to give. We're commanded to be baptized and partake of the Lord's Supper. We're commanded to witness for Christ. We're commanded to teach others to obey Christ. We've been given many commands in the New Testament. Yet, folks, none of these acts that you and I can do will justify us in the sight of God. One of the things that pushed Martin Luther over the edge was there was a Catholic preacher that was going around by the name of Johann Tetzel. And he was selling indulgences to people. In other words, when someone would come to him and say, well, I've sinned in this way, I've done this or I've done that, he would tell them some amount of money that they could give to the church, and by giving that money, they could be forgiven and relieved and justified from that sin. And that angered Martin Luther. Why? Because he realized that no religious act whatsoever could justify a man or a woman in the sight of God. That's all right. I've got what I need right here. You see, they realized that. And so that angered him. Well, if we see the wrong way for being justified, what's the right way? How can you be justified, declared righteous in the sight of God? Is it even possible? Is a question. And the question is answered by yes, a person can be justified. And justification is a free gift of God. Did you see that in verse number 24? Being justified, what? Freely by His grace. It's something that God does for me that I can't do for myself. It's something God does for me that I don't deserve. It's something that God does for you that you can't earn or pay for it. It's something that God freely, by His grace, gives to you and to me. And then let me say this, a person is not only justified as a free gift of God, but a person is justified through the blood of Jesus Christ. If you look over in Romans chapter 5 and verse number 9, the Bible says there, much more then, having now been justified by His blood, we shall be saved from wrath through Him. Now, you say, well, you believe God is just. When God declares us righteous, does He do it and just forget about our sins? No, He does it. Because He's dealt with our sins through His Son Jesus. You see, God will not wink at sin. God will not overlook sin. God will not tolerate sin. He is a holy God. He is a just God. Our sins must be dealt with. And when the Lord Jesus died on that cross, the Lord God Almighty laid on Jesus, His Son, the iniquity of us all. And when Jesus died on that cross, He shed His blood, paying my sin debt, paying your sin debt. He paid the price, the penalty in full on the cross, taken care of it one time for all times. Listen, the punishment was carried out by the shedding of Jesus' blood. And on the basis of the blood, you and I can receive a righteous standing before God. And then let me say, a person is justified not only freely as a gift of God's grace, not only through the blood of Jesus Christ, but through placing their faith in Jesus Christ. That is how it's received. God has made it possible. God does the justifying. And God tells us that in order to receive that word, that declaration, that pronouncement from the high courts of heaven, one must place their faith in Jesus. Look at verse number 28 of chapter 3. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith apart from the deeds of the law. Look over in chapter 4 and verse number 5. But to him who does not work but believes on Him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. In other words, by placing your faith in Jesus, God credits to your record in heaven the righteousness of Jesus Christ. You remember I just said a while ago, justification is not just a pardon. It's not just forgiveness. It's not just declaring that you're innocent. It is being pardoned, forgiven, declared innocent, and also giving a righteous record and standing in the courts of God. Faith. You say, what kind of faith are you talking about? Well, true justifying faith, folks, is not temporary. It's not something where one day you wake up and say, okay, well, I'm going to believe in Jesus and commit my heart and life to Him and place my trust in Him, and then down the road when things get tough, I'm just going to forget about it altogether. No, true justifying faith in the Lord Jesus Christ is a true, heartfelt, genuine, eternal commitment to Him. Then let me say, true justifying faith is not mere intellectual consent. It's not simply accepting the fact that there was a man born of a virgin. He lived a holy and a sinless life. He died on the cross for sinners. He shed His blood. He was buried in a tomb. He rose from the dead. Now, it's one thing to believe those facts. See, that's intellectual consent to the facts, the truths. But faith is more than just accepting the facts. By the way, James, in his little book, described the differences in faith. You see, the demons, they have that intellectual consent. They know that Jesus died on the cross and was buried and rose from the dead, but they don't have that true saving justified faith where they've committed their trust and their eternal destiny and they're standing before God in what Jesus did on the cross. There's a difference. True justifying faith is putting your trust and confidence in Jesus Christ. True justifying faith is an admission that you're spiritually bankrupt before God. You acknowledge that you're a sinner. You acknowledge that you have a guilty record. You acknowledge that you need assistance from on high to change your standing with God. That is involved in true justifying faith. True justifying faith is an act of commitment, where you're willing to say, God, I'm committing my entire life to Jesus as Savior. I'm committing my entire life to Jesus as my Lord. I'm committing my entire life, my spiritual standing, my eternal destiny, all that I am, all that I will be, all that I am in your sight. I'm committing it to the hands of Jesus Christ to take care of it and to make me acceptable in your sight. True justifying faith is a deliberate, initial, serious decision. It's making a decision where I realize that I'm a sinner. I realize that I need to be made righteous in the sight of God. I realize that there's only one way to do that, and that's through faith in the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm going to, at this pinpoint moment, Jesus, I'm trusting you. Jesus, I'm looking to you. Jesus, I'm committing my heart and life, placing my faith in you as my Lord and Savior. That's true justifying faith. Now you say, when one does that, what happens? Well, that leads us to our fourth point, and that is the act of justification. You see, justification is an instantaneous act of God in the courtrooms of heaven. Acts 13:39 says, and by him all who believe are justified. We sing that wonderful invitation hymn, only trust him, only trust him. Only trust him. Only trust him now. The next line says, he will save you. He will save you. He will save you what? Now. At that very instantaneous moment that you place your faith in Jesus, committing your heart and life to him as Savior and Lord, receiving what he did for you on the cross to make you have a right standing before God. That is instantaneous justifying faith. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to wait on it. You don't have to delay for it. I read about a King Henry IV in Germany many, many years ago who did something, and he fell out of proper standing with Pope Gregory. And so he went to Rome to try to receive forgiveness for his sins and to receive a new proper standing before God. And when he got there, Pope Gregory was gone, and he found that Gregory was gone off on a trip, and so the king made the trip to where the Pope was, and finally when he reached that house after that long trek, he finally was able to knock on the door and obtain an audience with the Pope and receive an absolution for his sins. Folks, let me tell you something. You don't have to travel over to Israel in the Holy Land. You don't have to travel to a church house. Folks, you can enter into the throne of God through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ anytime, any moment, any place, and instantaneously receive a pardon, a justification, a forgiveness from Almighty God. It's an instantaneous act. It's an irreversible act. I know sometimes we talk about eternal salvation, And this is one of the things that leads me to believe in the security of the believer. And that is, folks, the Greek term here and the whole concept is once a person is justified by God, they're not unjustified and have to be re-justified. Justified right then. It's an irreversible act. It's not a two-time thing. It's like in a court of law. If you're declared innocent in there, you can't be tried again for that same crime on the basis of the same evidence. That's impossible. That's legally incorrect. It's irreversible. Justification is an unpurchasable act. It's not something that you and I pay for. It's not based on what we do. It's based on what Jesus has already done. And then it's a divine act. Is something that God does for the believing sinner, not the believing sinner for God. Something where we come empty-handed. God, in my hand, no price I bring, but simply to the cross of your Son I cling. It's a divine act. And then finally, the blessings of being justified. What's so special about being justified? What's so wonderful? Number one, the full forgiveness of your sins. When you're justified, all of your sins are forgiven. When you're justified, there's the removal of sin's guilt and its punishment. You don't have to be guilty. You can walk before God as a righteous individual, knowing that He accepts you on the basis not of your life, not of your actions, but on the basis of what Christ has done for you. And then it entails the imputation of Christ's righteousness. I don't have time to get into this, but if you'll read on through chapter 3 and chapter 4 and then the first part of chapter 5, you'll discover different words: credited, accounted, imputed. And what those terms simply mean is that you don't have any righteousness. You may have been forgiven and now you're innocent, but God doesn't stop there. He then credits to your account the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And you know what that means? When He looks down at you and me, He don't see Tanner Mundy and you, He sees Jesus Christ. That's how He looks through us. He looks at us through the lenses of His Son Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? And then there is the perfect standing with God. When you're justified, you can lay your head down at night knowing that you're fully accepted by God. No matter what you've done, no matter who you are, no matter where you've come from, when God justifies you, you're perfectly accepted before Him. And then, here is my favorite. Romans 5:1 tells us that because we're justified, we have peace with God. You see, as a sinner, we're rejected by God. As a sinner, we're looked at as an enemy of God. But once we place our faith in Jesus, the battle is over. That's why salvation is referred to by many as surrender. It's truly simply saying, God, I'm spiritually bankrupt. God, I'm a sinner. God, I'm coming to You. Not on the basis of anything I've done, but I'm coming to You because I believe that what Jesus did on the cross, He did it for me. And at that very moment of committing your trust to Jesus as Savior and Lord, God says, righteous. Let's stand to our feet. Will God accept me? Yes. That's the whole basis of the doctrine of justification. Father, in Jesus' name, if there be one here and You're calling them today, they sense that they need to be justified in Your sight, I pray, God, that they would step out of that seat and walk down the aisle and meet me here at the front, so that I can pray with them and point them to You. God, I pray that You would take the truths that have been shared this morning and bring comfort and peace to every believer here, giving them that peace that they're perfectly accepted and have a perfect standing in your sight. God, we love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right.